It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Questions for the Premier. Premier, at yesterday's budget hearings, aviation sector representatives expressed a serious concern with your government's proposed 148% increase to the province's aviation fuel tax over the next 4 years. Marc-Andre O'Rourke, Executive Director of the National Airlines Council of Canada, collectively represents over 43,000 employees. He said that this tax increase could mean a loss of more than 2,000 jobs and 400,000 air travellers in Ontario alone. Yesterday, the Finance Minister was forced to admit that job losses would result from this fuel tax increase, so we blurted out that some airports might be exempt. He just didn't know which ones. So, Premier, Ontario can't afford more job losses. Will you defer implementing this tax increase until a full economic study is done?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, first, let me just say that the modest increase on the tax rate on aviation fuel is part of a comprehensive plan, Mr.
Order,
Speaker.
Order, please.
And it's a plan that we put forward in our budget when we brought the budget at the beginning of May. It's the plan that we ran on in the provincial election, Mr. Speaker, and it's a plan that we have reintroduced in this budget. And it's the plan, Mr. Speaker, that has led us to a situation where two rating agencies, both S&P, Standard & Poor's, and DBRS, have not, Mr. Speaker, chosen to downgrade Ontario, have actually confirmed our outlook, Mr. Speaker. So it seems to me that if Standard & Poor's is saying Ontario's fiscal management
Answer.
Is strong, this is part of the fiscal management plan that we put forward, so we're going to stick with it, Mr. Speaker.
Premier, the fact that your finance minister was unprepared to tell us yesterday who would be exempt from this tax increase just demonstrates that, once again, you're barreling ahead with a tax increase without considering who you're hurting. Don McDougall, chair of the Kenora Airport Board, said that this fuel tax increase will be devastating to Kenora's small airport and give Americans cause to reconsider flying directly to Kenora. Kenora is just one of many airports and small communities across Ontario which will suffer from your actions. Premier, if you won't conduct an impact study, will you at least answer the question that your finance minister couldn't answer yesterday? Which Ontario airports will be exempt from the aviation fuel tax increase?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I applaud the late-breaking concern for the North from the party across the floor, Mr. Speaker, because the fact is, from the outset, we have said that small and northern airports would receive special consideration, Mr. Speaker, because we understand that there is a concern with those airports, because we actually care deeply about what happens in the north. We care deeply about the northern economy, Mr. Speaker, and that is why, from the outset, we said that that was a concern in this instance. But the fact is that this is a modest increase. This is the aviation fuel tax has not increased since 1992. And if you look at other jurisdictions, if you look at London Heathrow, their aviation fuel tax is 69.6 cents per litre. Ours is 2.7 cents per litre, Mr. Speaker. We are making a fiscally sound decision.
Here. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, we're not only concerned about small airports in the north, we're concerned about airports in central and southern Ontario also. Right from London to Collingwood, to Owen Sound, to Barrie, to Buttonville, you name it. You know, you said in your budget you weren't going to increase taxes on the middle class. I guess you think just rich people and business people fly. Fact of the matter is, more middle class average families fly every year. And you're hitting the middle class with this tax increase. People fly to visit their children at university. Kids fly home. They fly to visit a sick parent overseas. They fly to reconnect with family members. That's the vast majority of people. They fly to go on a well-deserved vacation. That's the vast majority of flying. You're hurting the middle class. You failed to consider the impact of this tax increase on the middle class. So will you defer
the Minister of Economic Development come to order?
Aviation question tax increase until a full study of its economic impact has been undertaken.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, again, it's very interesting that this reaction is coming from the party opposite, when really it's federal taxes and fees, yeah. Mr. Speaker, that actually increase the cost the most, Mr. Speaker. This modest increase that we are putting forward in our budget will have a minimal impact on travellers, Mr. Speaker, and that's up to the organizations to make a decision on how they pass that along. The fact is that the analysis that we have seen shows that there will be very little impact on airlines and on passengers, but we've also said that the small and northern airports need special consideration, Mr. Speaker. But we also know that the transportation and transit infrastructure that we are going to build, Mr. Speaker, as a result of our plan, and this is part of our plan, that actually will help the airline industry, Mr. Speaker. That will actually help our airports. Yeah. That infrastructure is well needed across the province.
Any question? The member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Thanks, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, your Treasury Board president claimed yesterday that Metrolinx would not cut service levels to pay for the 8.5% wage increase you doled out to 1,850 transit workers in June. Does that mean you're planning to pass these costs on to GO riders with even higher fares?
Good question.
Mr. Speaker, I know that the President of the Treasury Board will want to comment on this, but I just want to reinforce what I said yesterday, which is that we are well aware that in terms of collective bargaining with public sector employees, that it is very necessary that we hold to the funding levels that are in place now and that we work to bargain within those funding levels. That's exactly what happened with Metrolinx, the increases over the 4 years, because the member opposite is making it sound like that increase is all in 1 year, but it is not. It is over 4 years, Mr. Speaker. So that increase of about 2% a year, Mr. Speaker, is found within the funding levels that already exist. That's what we have committed to. That's what has been delivered in this collective agreement, Mr. Speaker.
Premier, you should know that millions of dollars for pay hikes can't be created out of thin air. You need to cover these new costs either by cutting services or by raising revenue. And so far, you've shown that your favorite method to make up for the shortfalls is raising
fares. Fees and taxes.
Premier, can you tell this House how much in total your 8.5% pay raise for 1,850 workers will cost?
That's not zero.
So, Mr. Speaker, let me just use an example, because I think this is a broader issue. You know, the members on the other side immediately go to cutting and slashing services. That's the framework within which they operate. That was their entire platform. That's what they campaigned.
The member from Renfrew will come to order. Please finish.
Let me give you an example of how you can constrain costs, change the way service is delivered, Mr. Speaker, at the same time. If you look at the health care system in Ontario, you look at the way services are being changed in terms of moving them into the community, making sure that people get health care and home care at home rather than in an acute care bed, Mr. Speaker, that kind of transformation has the benefit of saving money, Mr. Speaker, and delivering better service. That's what we're talking about.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Premier, you have consistently raised transit fares while adding more than 225 Metrolinx employees to the Sunshine List since 2007.
Wow.
With hundreds of Metrolinx staff already making more than $100,000 a year, could you explain how many more will soon be added to the Sunshine List with your 8.5% wage increase?
Well, Mr. Speaker, the reality is that we believe that supporting and investing in transit, whether it is GO service, Mr. Speaker, whether it's municipal transit, we actually have that as a foundation of our economic plan, Mr. Speaker. We know how important it is to the people who travel regionally in the Greater Toronto Hamilton area and to people across the province, so that making those investments in transit and transit transportation infrastructure is foundational to our plan. So the member opposite is going to try to undermine that plan. He is going to try to make a critique of that plan that will stick. In fact, Mr. Speaker, we know that people want more investment in transit. They want to be able to travel full day, two-way go, Mr. Speaker. And that is the plan that we are putting forward. Those are the investments that we are going to make, and
Thank
it
you.
Will benefit his constituents,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Yesterday, I called on the Premier to support a review of the fiscal plan by the Auditor General.
Good
it's
idea.
Exactly what the Fiscal Transparency and Accountability Act calls for, an independent review of the government's budget in each election year. It's the only time when the auditor actually examines the government's revenue projections, the government's expense estimates, and the government's fiscal assumptions. It's the one opportunity for Ontarians to hear from an independent officer about whether the budget can be trusted. My question is a simple one, Speaker. Will the Premier submit her fiscal plan for review by the auditor or not?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So we'll go over this again. The Auditor General looks at our finances every year as part of public accounts, Mr. Speaker. This is happening now, and that report will be tabled in the fall. We were on track to have a pre-election audit until the NDP and the PCs decided that it was time for an election, Mr. Speaker. Otherwise, that would have happened, Mr. Speaker. So the fact is that, as I said yesterday, the leader of the third party is looking for any reason, whether it is real or illusory, not to support the budget that we have put forward, Mr. Right. Speaker, not to support the initiatives that will help the very families whom she references on a regular basis. That's what she's doing, Mr. Speaker. We know that the Auditor General will
Answer.
Do her work and that that report will be tabled in the fall.
Thank you.
Well, Speaker, it looks to me like the Premier is grasping for any reason not to be upfront with the people about the state of the province's finances. In 2004, the Premier actually supported the Fiscal Transparency and Accountability Act to crack down on the notoriously inaccurate budgets that governments campaign on. Back then, she understood, Speaker, that independent oversight in election years is actually a good idea. Today, the Premier can follow through by requesting under Section 17 of the Auditor General Act that the auditor promptly review the fiscal plan and report publicly on her findings. Will the Premier do the right thing and request that independent review today, Speaker?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So we made it clear that we were on track to have that that audit done. There was an election that was called, Mr. Speaker, as a result of the actions of the NDP and the Conservatives, Mr. Speaker. And we made a commitment to come back and make sure.
The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek, come to order. The member from Eglinton Lawrence, come to order. Minister of Government Services, come to order. And again, the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek. Carry on, please. Finish up.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, the fact is that the election happened because the NDP and the Conservatives decided not to support the budget that
Answer.
They reintroduced. I want to quote from the Standard & Poor's report from yesterday, Mr. Speaker. Ontario's financial management is strong in our view. The level of transparency and disclosure in its financial...
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, there's a big difference, and this Premier knows it, between the auditor's annual reports and what we are asking for today and what we asked for yesterday, Speaker. Election years are the one time when the auditor looks forward, not backward, and assesses the government's plan for the next 3 years. That's how the auditor caught this very government in 2011 using overly optimistic projections that put the province at risk for higher deficits. In fact, the very same higher deficit that we see today, Speaker. So my question is simple, and it deserves a straightforward answer from this Premier, Speaker. Will the Premier respect the Act, or will she not?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. We would have had that review had the election not been called, Mr. Speaker, and that was the leader of the third party's decision. Let me quote from Standard & Poor's yesterday. Ontario's financial management is strong in our view. The level of transparency and disclosure in its financial statements is high. Notes and schedules provide detailed information about core government agencies and boards and business enterprises. The Independent Auditor General audits the province's financial statements. Mr. Speaker, that is the reality. That report will be tabled in the fall. We were on track to have that review, but the election has happened, Mr. Speaker, and we made a commitment to bring the budget back. That's what we're doing, and we're going to work to implement that budget if it passes this legislation. Thank you.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. New question. Leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. You know, Speaker, for weeks, New Democrats have been asking straightforward questions about the Premier's fire sale of public assets, her cuts to public services, and her layoffs of up to 100,000 people. She has refused to answer those questions, Speaker, questions that families are asking. That's her decision. But it doesn't mean that Ontarians have to live in the dark, Speaker. We can get answers by calling on the Auditor General if only this Premier will allow it. Why is the Premier refusing to allow independent verification of her election budget, Speaker?
The Minister of Economic Development and Employment and Infrastructure will come to order. Please carry on.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, you know, despite the rhetoric coming from the Leader of the Third Party, the fact is that we have put in place a group led by Ed Clark, who is looking at our assets and is working to give us advice on how to optimize those assets. Those are assets that are owned by the people of Ontario, and I believe that it is responsible for us to make sure that they are working to the best of the advantage of the people of the province. Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General and the people of the province can see that the details of that are on page 164 of the budget, Mr. Speaker, but that work is ongoing. Those decisions have not been made. So the suggestion from the Leader of the Third Party that somehow there is a nefarious plot and decisions that have already been made that are being kept from the people of Ontario is just not the reality. The work is ongoing. We are going to review those assets. Ed Clark is doing that work for us. He is going to give us advice, and then we will make it clear what our intentions are, Mr. Speaker.
Complimentary.
Speaker, what's nefarious is a government that's not prepared to answer straightforward questions about its own budget. That's what's nefarious. But this Premier is refusing to answer those basic questions, Speaker, and she's preventing the Auditor General from giving us those answers. That's very odd, because this very Premier supported the Auditor's review in 2004, in 2007, and in 2011. Why is she standing in the way of the Auditor's review now that she's in charge, Speaker?
Well, here's a more immediate and puzzling question, Mr. Speaker. The Leader of the Third Party based her platform on our fiscal plan and then said she was going to cut $600 million more dollars, Mr. Speaker, and now she's not supporting any part of our plan. She's not supporting $2.5 billion in Jobs and Prosperity Fund. She's not supporting $130 billion in infrastructure investments. She's not supporting a Made in Ontario retirement pension plan. She's not supporting increasing the Ontario child benefit. She's not supporting $810 million in supports for adults with developmental disabilities. She's not supporting expanding low-income health benefits. And she's not supporting $20 million for expansion of student nutrition programs. I think it's very puzzling as to why she's not supporting those things. Maybe she has an answer for the people of Ontario.
You see it, please. You see it, please. Final supplementary.
Of Ontario will be disappointed to see that they have a Premier that's not supporting fundamental transparency and accountability of her budget, Speaker. In 2004, the member from Eglinton Lawrence, supported the budget oversight by the Auditor General by saying, quote, no governing party can again pull the wool over our eyes, end quote. He was right. It's a good idea to get the auditors look at the books every single election year, without exception, Speaker. No one should be above the rules, and no election should become an excuse to avoid fundamental oversight, Speaker. Why does the Premier think that Dalton McGuinty's transparency and accountability measures are too good for her own government?
Well, I actually don't, Mr. Speaker, and as I said, we were on track to have that review, but there was an election called, Mr. Speaker, as a result of the NDP, and the Conservatives not supporting the budget. We ran on that budget, Mr. Speaker. The Auditor General is looking at our fiscal fundamentals, and that report will be tabled in the fall, Mr. Speaker. But, you know, the fact is that the plan we ran on had $50 million for a new local poverty reduction fund in it, Mr. Speaker. Speaker, the leader of the third party is not supporting that. There's a child care modernization and there are investments in early learning, Mr. Speaker, in our budget. The leader of the third party is not supporting that. She's not supporting wage increases for personal support workers, Mr. Speaker, and she's not supporting new funding for long-term care homes, and she's not supporting a comprehensive Aboriginal action plan,
Answer.
Mr. Speaker. I think that the people of Ontario deserve to know why she and her party are not supporting those
Thank
progressive
you.
Measures, Mr. Speaker.
The member from Wellington, Halton Hills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. In a press conference on Friday, the minister admitted that the goal of his government's youth job strategy is to create opportunities and experience, not meaningful long-term employment. He added that his programs don't have a good long-term success rate. But yesterday, in a staged set-up law ball question in this House from the member for Burlington, the minister bragged about the success of his youth job programs. Why was the minister saying one thing on Friday and something very different in this House yesterday?
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I might suggest the member directly quote me next time instead of saying things that I'm allegedly saying. The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, our youth job strategy has created 20,000 job opportunities for young people since September. And here's the good news. Because we've been very clear about that. When it comes to the Youth Employment Fund, it's 4 to 6 month opportunities to experience real-life employment. 95% of the students, the 4,800 that have gone through the program so far, have been retained by those businesses or have found jobs elsewhere. Mr. Speaker, I don't expect it to stay at that level of retention. I think that would be unrealistic. But, Mr. Speaker, the program's off to a great start. 20,000 job opportunities since the fall. That's phenomenal, Mr. Speaker. We're proud of the program, and we're going to keep working at it.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the press were at the event on Friday. They heard what he said. A cynic once said that a political gaffe is when a politician accidentally tells the truth. The minister's behaviour in recent days serves to reinforce this view. The truth is that the youth unemployment rate in Ontario is at more than 15% today. Surely this is unacceptable to the minister, just as it should be to all members of this House. We've all met bright, enthusiastic young people who've gotten their degrees or certificates and who are discouraged because after months or even years of trying, can't find that career-track first job. If the minister knows that his programs aren't working, as he seemed to understand on Friday, when will he announce a youth job strategy that will work?
20,000 jobs created for young people, Mr. Speaker. 20,000 job opportunities for young people created since the fall. You find me a program that's been more successful anywhere in North America than our youth job strategy, Mr. Speaker. I bet you can't. We recognize that youth unemployment's too high. That's why the Premier, as myself and my colleagues, can move forward, Mr. Speaker, to bring forward a youth job strategy, Mr. Speaker. We're responding, we're creating those opportunities, we're increasing entrepreneurial opportunities, we're building our innovation agenda to help those
Answer.
Young people that want to create jobs or start their own businesses. Mr. Speaker, you cannot find a program anywhere in North America.
Uh,
I'm just going to be seated, please. Order. Order. I'm going to use this opportunity, now that I've stopped the clock, to remind all members that this is part of the problem when you don't address the chair. When I stand, you sit. If you end up arguing with somebody across the way, you don't see that I'm standing, and you're not sitting when you should. So all of us would be better served if you direct your questions and answers to the chair. New question. The member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. My question to the Premier. On page 4 of the Liberal Party's infrastructure platform, and I took a look at it again this morning, clearly says this government's plan is to pocket $3.15 billion from the sale of public assets. Neither you, Premier, nor the Minister of Finance have explained how much of this money is going to come from the sale of all or part of LCBO, Ontario Power Generation, or Hydro One. Will the Premier finally tell the House how much is slotted into the government's fiscal framework from the full or partial sale of these core public assets?
Good question.
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
So, Mr. Speaker, we are doing a full review of our assets for LCBO, OLG, OPA, and we're looking at all of our assets, including real estate and those shares that we own in private companies, and we're going to ensure that we maximize its opportunity to increase dividends to the province of Ontario and to the taxpayers who own these organizations, and it's prudent for us to do so. The member, I appreciate, has looked at some of the numbers, and he'll be able to reflect on the fact that the valuations of many of these organizations are tremendous. What we want to do is safeguard the public interest, be fully transparent in the things that we do. In the meantime, some of the things that we're going to roll out are very quick to suggest some of the real estate that is owned by the province and some of the shares that we own as well. That is partly of what we're going to be doing in the short term. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, that was hardly an answer. Let's face it, when you put that figure into your platform, someone, hopefully, had a sense of the ballpark value of what would be coming from those different asset sales. How much of that $3.15 billion from the sale of LCBO, OPG, and Hydro One is allocated to those assets, or was your number just a guess in the platform?
Mr. Finance.
So, Mr. Speaker, we're unlocking value of our assets. We're not suggesting that we're going to sell any three of those organizations that you've just mentioned. We want to maximize the potential of the revenue generated from those organizations. We are looking at assets that can be sold in the short term. And I've just stated, there's a number of properties in real estate that we own as a landlord that are unproductive. We also have shares in various companies that, again, are passive, and they can be better reinvested into the Trillium Trust to produce transportation, infrastructure, things that make us competitive. Those are tabulated, and those will be the things that we're going to release. It'd be inappropriate for me to suggest anything until the review has been done. Furthermore, it's also implicating the public interest by showing public in terms of the valuations of these companies. That, too, is inappropriate, Mr. Speaker. We are looking after the public interest, and we'll continue to do so.
Question, the member from Dundee-Prescott-Russell.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation. Minister, Ontario does have the safest roads in North America, and something all Ontarians could be proud of. And as a member for Glengarry Prescott Russell, and I travel almost 1,500 kilometres a week, Speaker, we recognize how important it is in keeping our roads safe. Contrary to the gorgeous, humid weather outside today, we know that winters can be harsh in the province. And we saw that last winter with more storms than we've been used to in quite some time. This affects how people do things every day, including business or even going for grocery shopping, which I love. This, Speaker, some of my constituents have expressed concerns about our roads during winter and particularly after storms, and they're concerned about how fast we clean the roadways of snow and ice. Through you, Speaker, can the minister please speak to the improvements that this government has made in our road winter maintenance programs?
Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. And I want to thank the member from Glengarry Prescott Russell for his question and for his advocacy. That member is quite correct, Speaker. Ontario has some of the safest roads across North America. In fact, Speaker, we are so committed to road safety that here we are in the middle of July or near the end of July talking about winter maintenance, even when the temperatures outside today are hovering around 30 degrees. Our winter maintenance standards are among the highest or best in North America, Speaker. But we are always looking to improve our winter maintenance program. As an example, this past winter, we added 55 additional winter maintenance units. 42 of those additional units were provided to Northern Ontario. Speaker, we have made significant investments in roads across Ontario to ensure they are safe no matter the season, and I'm happy to report, Speaker, to the House that the Ministry of Transportation will provide all interested MPPs with a technical briefing on this particular issue come this fall. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for that very comprehensive answer. My riding of Glengarry Prescott Russell is a great place to live and do business. That's why it's important to have safe roads for every type of commuter. Speaker, I understand that Ontario's winter road maintenance is performed by maintenance contractors, and my constituents are interested in knowing more about these contractors. The people in my riding want to make sure that they're getting good value for their tax dollars. They also want to know who's keeping their roads safe when the snow is falling and on the ground. So through you, Speaker, could the Minister please speak to Ontario's relationships with our contractors?
Thank you, Minister.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I want to thank the member again for his supplementary question and for the fantastic work that he does on behalf of the people of his community. Contracts, as he mentioned, with area maintenance contractors are performance-based, Speaker. Our contractors bid in a competitive environment for their contracts, and there are 31 performance indicators which contractors are required to meet. The number one indicator, Speaker, is making sure that the roads have bare pavement, clean of all ice and snow. Bare pavement, Speaker, ensures safety for all commuters. The Ministry of Transportation has always had a good relationship with the Contractors Association, the Ontario Road Builders Association, and we look forward to continuing our strong working relationship with this association again leading up to the next winter season. Although I'm sure we can all agree, Mr. Speaker, we hope winter doesn't come too soon.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Melbourne, Middlesex, London.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Premier, as you traveled the province during the election, you're greeted by wind turbine protesters in almost every rural riding.
Yep.
Obviously, these Ontarians are fed up. They've watched their pristine rural landscapes destroyed by costly wind turbines that carry a myriad of consequences. You have said that you wanted to improve the approval process for wind developments to allow for more local input. However, you stated on numerous occasions that you remain fully committed to wind turbines, and the fact that you have not given municipalities the final say over wind turbine developments indicates to me that this promise is more smoke than mirrors than anything else. Yep. Premier, which is it? Do you want to continue to push unwanted wind farms in rural communities, or will you finally step up and give local municipalities a true say in their communities?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I think we just need to be clear. I mean, what is happening is the OPA is creating the Ontario Power Authority is creating a new competitive bidding process in which projects that have the support of local communities will be given priority. So when we said that we were going to work with communities and make sure that there was much more buy-in, that that municipalities would have a greater say in siting renewable energy projects, that's exactly what we have done, Mr. Speaker. That's exactly what we've done, and in fact, the OPA and the IESO have engaged with municipalities, with First Nations leaders, with community associations, and with others to get that input. So that's the work that was done in order to come up with the process that actually weights those projects that have community buy-in. What the member opposite is asking for is a veto, and the member opposite is basically saying he doesn't support the renewable energy industry. We know that, Mr. Speaker, but we do, and we know how important it is to the future of the province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
To go back to the Premier. Premier, I'm asking for the veto for our municipalities, just like rural Ontario vetoed the Liberals.
Here, here.
Premier, the west end of my riding borders on the Chatham-Kent region, where residents have had hundreds of turbines forced upon them. Those in my riding who live in West Elgin and Dutton-Dudgewit look to the west and fear the same thing will happen to them. In fact, there's a developmental proposal currently on the table. Residents in West Elgin fear for their health, they fear for their property values, and they fear for the destruction of the social fabric. It's one of the reasons West Elgin Council voted to be an unwilling host of this development. Also, Municipality Dutton-Dunwich issued a survey to area residents. 84% of the residents do not want wind turbines in Dutton-Dunwich. Clearly, it's an unwanted project. Premier, will you listen to the will of the local municipalities, or do you think the people in my riding are just wrong?
Good question.
Well, let me
Let me first say that I would love to introduce the member opposite to some of our new members and the members who represent the rural constituents, for example, in Northumberland Quinte West and in Durham, Mrs. Speaker, and Glengarry Prescott Russell. I'm sure that there are some rural members who would feel there's some rural constituents who would feel quite insulted by the comments of the member opposite. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, the reality is that we have made changes to the process. We have consulted with communities across the province, and the OPA is putting in place a competitive bidding process that actually weights the siting of projects towards municipalities that are open to them and are interested in having them, Mr. Speaker. I have said in this House that if I could roll back the clock and we could have had that process from the beginning, Mr. Speaker, that would be a good thing. But the fact is, we can't. We need to have a process that takes those concerns into account now. That's what we have, Mr. Speaker, and we will continue to work with municipalities to make sure that we have a renewable industry in this province, that we have the cleanest air and the cleanest energy anywhere. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Question, a member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health. When patients need care at a hospital, they shouldn't have to pay through the nose just to park their car. But after 3 years of frozen budgets from this government, hospitals are passing the buck to patients by charging up to $25 a day. This government's healthcare austerity has let parking fees get out of control, and patients are paying the price. Will the minister admit that another year of hospital austerity will only leave families falling further behind?
Well,
thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm glad to hear from the third party that there's another piece of our platform that you like. Because you didn't mention during the campaign nor in your platform capping parking fees. It's a commitment that we made during the election and in our platform, and we stand by that commitment. Our government is going to bring in, Mr. Speaker, a realistic plan to help Ontarians with their living costs today as it pertains to hospital parking fees. And I've engaged my ministry. I've asked them at the earliest possible moment for us to come up with a reasonable plan that reflects not only the needs of hospitals to be able to generate sufficient revenue for their activities, but addresses this priority issue to make sure that patients and their families have access to those hospitals, and that costs should not and will not be an impediment, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. This government has made many promises, but they refuse to talk about the actual budget. The fact is that this Trojan horse budget continues to squeeze our health care system. Patients in Hamilton have seen a 25% increase in hospital parking fees this spring. They're being charged $25 a day before they even enter the hospital to get the treatment that they need. That's not what public health care should be. Will this minister tell Ontarians why there is nothing in this budget to get outrageous parking lot user fees under control?
Thank you, Minister.
We're making our argument.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I remain confused by the supplementary question, because I was very clear, I think, in my first response that this is an issue that is a priority for this side of the legislature. It was not a priority for the third party, for the NDP party. We made a commitment during the platform, during the campaign, to address this issue, as it's an important issue for many Ontarians. And just to repeat, Mr. Speaker, we remain committed. Our government will bring in a realistic plan to help individuals across the province address the issue of parking fees in hospitals. I don't understand why the member of the third party can't accept this commitment, and yes, as an answer to your question, but if it had been a priority, I wish you had have addressed it during the campaign. You didn't. We did. We're following through on that commitment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. I was very pleased to see the government reintroduce the Child Care Modernization Act just a week ago. I know that in my riding of Beaches, East York, as in so many of your ridings, many families and child care operators will benefit significantly from these changes. I understand that this bill, if passed, will strengthen oversight of the province's unlicensed child care sector while increasing access to licensed child care options for families. Mr. Speaker, I'm even more pleased that our government has placed a priority on reforming a piece of legislation that hasn't been changed for 30 years, that neither of the parties opposite had an opportunity to took the time to amend in their time in office. So much of this proposed legislation is aimed at addressing oversight with the unlicensed sector. And
question.
I ask Mr. Speaker, I ask the minister, can she describe how the legislation will strengthen and improve oversight?
Thank you. Wow. Minister Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker, and congratulations to the members from Beaches East York who gave a great maiden speech last week. And the member is absolutely correct. This legislation is well overdue for a comprehensive update. That's why in December of 2013, our government first introduced the Child Care Modernization Act. Unfortunately, the bill was debate was cut short. We had this election happen. But I'm proud of the legislation, and we have reintroduced it in this House. It will, if passed, improve oversight in the unlicensed sector and modernize the province's child care system. Speaker, well over a year ago, we began to consult with parents and stakeholders on how to update the legislation. And if passed, the Child Care Modernization Act will allow the province to immediately shut down a child care provider when a child's safety is at risk. Yep. It will clarify what
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the minister for her response and particularly for her commendations on my inaugural speech. I also know that our government has already taken steps to improve the oversight of child care. These include a dedicated enforcement team to investigate complaints against unlicensed operators and the development of online searchable databases of validated complaints. Mr. Speaker, we need to take further action to strengthen the oversight in the child care sector. And can the minister, Mr. Speaker, through you, please share with the House why this piece of legislation is critical and why it needs to move through the legislative process?
Thank you. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. The Child Care Modernization Act makes a number of amendments that will, or a number of things that will improve oversight and organization of the child care sector. In addition to those things I already mentioned, it will improve access to licensed child care and support parent choice. It will enhance and clarify the provincial, municipal, and First Nations partnerships in the child care sector. And it would amend the Education Act to ensure school boards offer before and after school programs for 6 to 12 year olds when there is sufficient demand. And Speaker, it will also ensure for the first time that Ministry of Education inspectors have the authority to impose administrative penalties of up to $100,000 when people break the unlicensed home care rules. So, Speaker, it is absolutely critical that we get this act
passed.
Thank
you.
I look for.
Thank you. New question. The member from Parry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Natural Resources. Minister, the Magnetowan River in my riding of Parry Sound, Muskoka is a natural feature that shapes a number of communities. With headwaters in Algonquin Park, the river flows through Burke's Falls, Magnetowan First Nation, before emptying into Bing Inlet at Britt on Georgian Bay. In recent years, there have been issues with increased silt levels being deposited into the river. This causes higher turbidity of the water and is plainly visible from a number of locations. I've met with concerned constituents who have spent their life living near the river, who know the river. They've never seen it muddied up like it has been this year. Ryerson Township Council has also contacted me with regard to this important issue. Minister, what is being done by your government to protect the Magnetowan River?
Thank you to the member for the question and an opportunity to respond. I don't mind saying it's an issue that I have not been briefed on. I have not received any correspondence from the member on this particular issue. I guess if I was to look for a parallel, I would perhaps talk about what we deal with on a regular basis when we think of lower or higher water levels in the Great Lakes, when we are called upon to make decisions on how we are going to maintain the integrity of ecological systems, water levels, and their impact on local communities. As I've mentioned in my opening remark, I have not heard from the member on this. I'm happy to work with him to see what's possible and what we can bring to the table to help the affected community and the people around there that use this river system, and I look forward to discussing it in greater length with the member.
Yeah, yeah.
go forward.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Minister. Minister, there are currently two solar farms that lie very close proximity to the Magnetawan River near Burke's Falls. Through your government and the Green Energy Act, permits for these projects were approved. The removal of natural vegetation is surely a contributing factor to the significant runoff deposited into the river during seasonal rain events so far this summer. The full effects of greater sediment levels entering the river and the subsequent impact on the natural ecosystem of the Magnetawan are unknown. Minister, will you commit to looking into this issue to ensure that this important natural resource can continue to be enjoyed by future generations?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Speaker, again, thank the member for the question. As I mentioned in the opening remark, I have not heard from the member on this particular issue. He's now in his supplementary connected what's going on with the river system to a green energy project. I would have appreciated having heard from the member on the particular issue. We haven't. I commit to working with him and the community on the issue on a go-forward basis, and I thank him for the heads up through question period.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Kenora Rainy River.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier. Speaker, in the recent throne speech, this government reaffirmed its commitment to Ontario's First Nations people. And yet last week we learned that a long-promised public inquest into the tragic deaths of seven First Nations youth in Thunder Bay won't be proceeding now, anytime soon, or maybe ever. The chief coroner, an officer of this House, made the decision not to proceed, saying that ongoing issues with the underrepresentation of First Nations on juries in Thunder Bay is an issue, and also that the complexity of the issue is a contributing factor as to why there will not be an inquest. Speaker, seven youths who have had to leave their home communities in order to get a high school education have wound up dead. Families and Northerners have been waiting for over 10 years for answers, and they're still waiting. Will this government take immediate steps to rectify the underrepresentation of First Nations on juries so we can finally go forward with this inquest?
Thank you.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you for that question, and thank you for raising this very important issue. I can tell the member opposite that about this time last year, I was in Thunder Bay, and I met with the parents of the students who had been killed. They had been brought into one of the local high schools, and they were doing some preparation work, getting ready for the inquest, which was to start at about this time. Along with that, we have the Iacobucci report, which made certain recommendations about the selection of jurors on criminal panels. And the coroner's jury, the coroner has also suggested that those same recommendations ought to be implemented into coroner's juries so that there's the sufficient representation of First Nation members on coroner's jury. Accordingly, he has adjourned the inquest so that he can make arrangements to perhaps work with some of the recommendations in the Iacobucci report to ensure that First Nations participate not only in criminal juries, civil juries, but in coroner's juries. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, Jethro Anderson, 15. Karan Strong, 18. Paul Panichese, 17. Robin Harper, 18. Reggie Bushy, 15. Kyle Morriso, 17. Jordan Wabos, 15. Their mothers and families deserve answers. You have to wonder if it was seven kids somewhere in southwestern Ontario who died tragically, would there be any hesitation to overcome the roadblocks and call an inquest to get to the bottom of it? Speaker, will this government finally take action to address the systemic issues with jury selection the coroner cited as preventing a public inquest from going forward, and call an inquest into the deaths of these youth right away?
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Speaker, and thanks to the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs for providing clarity on the first answer. Ontario is very committed to building strong relationships with First Nations, Métis, Inuit and urban Aboriginal partners. And working together, Speaker, we can improve opportunities and outcomes for Aboriginal youth and their families. We are currently developing an Aboriginal Children Youth Strategy to transform how services are designed and delivered to improve outcomes for Aboriginal children and youth. And this outcome is underway. It's very community-driven, Speaker, integrating culturally appropriate appropriate supports for children so that services can better meet their needs. And as the minister, the new Minister of Children and Youth Services, I look forward very much to spearheading this in cooperation with my colleagues and my critic for Children and Youth Services.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No question? The member from Halton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade. In my community of Halton, there are many examples of outstanding contributions from remarkable constituents who have made our community a better place to work and live. Former and current residents like astronaut Chris Hadfield and Olympian Travis Garretts are two examples of exemplary individuals who have made exceptional contributions to our community and our province. Honours and awards are one of the best ways that outstanding citizens in Halton and across Ontario can be recognized for their contributions and to their communities. They acknowledge achievements and celebrate people's deep commitments to making communities like Halton the thriving, caring and communal places they are.
Question.
Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, how can Ontarians recognize exceptional members in their communities?
Good question.
Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you very much for the question. Speaker, this is the first time I receive a question from the new member. Speaker, I worked with the member in the past, and I can tell you she's going to be a great MPP for the people of Halton. Speaker, Ontario is a land of opportunity, incredibly diverse, and many people have done great things. Speaker, this is why Ontario has a number of honours and awards that recognize individuals who, through exceptional long-term efforts, have made outstanding contributions to their community. Speaker, the prestigious honours include the Order of Ontario, the Medal for Good Citizenship, Medal for Young Volunteers, Award for Leadership in Immigrant Employment, Lincoln Alexander Award, June Cole
Answer.
Outstanding Achievement Award, and the Ontario Newcomer Champion Award, just to name a few, Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for providing great insight into this very important cause. Mr. Speaker, Halton's first responders are among the best in the province. Every day, these outstanding individuals put their lives on the line to protect and serve the great residents of my community. Our police and firefighters' courage and life-saving skills often make the difference between life and death. I know firsthand the outstanding work these first responders do, from their presence in the community to assisting Halton residents through challenging times of distress. They can always be counted on to be there when we need them most. When we are in greatest need, they are always there to help and protect us and our families. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, how does the province recognize the great bravery
Question.
Of police officers and firefighters in Halton and Ontario?
Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade.
For the question again, I want to also remind all of the members of this House that that nomination for the Ontario Medal for firefighter and police bravery are fast approaching. Both of these honourable medals recognize individual acts of outstanding courage and bravery by members of Ontario's firefighting and police services. For more information on how to nominate a police officer or firefighter from your community, I invite all of you to please visit the Ontario Honours and Awards website today at www.citizenship.gov.on.ca. Speaker, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the police and firefighters
Answer.
For their hard work day in and day out to serve and protect us all.
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? The member from Bruce Gray, Owen South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
My question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. Minister, I recently wrote you, just as I wrote your predecessors, asking you to review a proposal from Georgian College to invest $2 million from the Public Infrastructure Funds Program to move the Marine Emergency Duties Training and Research Program to the Owen Sound campus. As you know, MET is a compulsory training program for the marine industry and is currently unavailable anywhere in central Canada. It provides jobs such as marine engineers, mechanics, technicians, and navigators that are all required to sustain the $6 billion industry. Your government opted to give $220 million public dollars to a private firm called Cisco, yet gave no such support to a public institution that plays a key role in the economy of Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, and the province. So my question to you is simple, Minister. Do you agree that public infrastructure money should be going to public institutions? Yes or no?
Thank you, Minister of Economic Development and Employment.
What I believe, Mr. Speaker, is that the PC party should be supporting our budget that's going to invest $130 billion over 10 years in infrastructure programs that will be going to public institutions, Mr. Speaker, including building transit, including investing in our training colleges and universities facilities, including investing in health care and education buildings. That's, Mr. Speaker, what I believe, and I would think the member would agree with that. If he does, he should support our upcoming budget. That being said, the member brought this to my attention in my previous post prior to the election, and it's something that we are looking into on his behalf. And he did, as he said, provide me with information on it yesterday. I'm going to refer the supplementary to my colleague, the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities, who has more carriage of this matter in the supplementary, Mr. Speaker. But I do thank the member for bringing it to my attention.
Good supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Actually, I want to go back to the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. Minister, you suggested in yesterday's question period that nobody in North America was doing more for young people than your Liberal government. I suggest to you that Georgian College's key proposal is a key investment in our post-secondary education and skills training for our youth. If you make a priority, I believe you could actually leverage Infrastructure Canada funds and make this project a reality. So, Minister, here's an opportunity to take real action as opposed to just talk and make a critical infrastructure investment that would be a key source of jobs at a time when unemployment is stuck at 7% and youth unemployment hovers at a critical 21% in Bruce Gray, Owen Sound. Minister, with the $130 billion that you've mentioned allocated for public infrastructure, are you prepared to support this critical investment in a public institution and ensure that Georgian College remains a key leader in our education sector and supports the sustainability of the valued marine sector in Ontario?
Thank you.
I refer this to the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities, Research and Innovation.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I want to thank the member opposite for that question. Mr. Speaker, it's crucial for us and also for the industry to make sure that marine emergency duty training is going on in our colleges, including Georgian College. It was the federal government, actually, who closed this place. And it was this government last year. We invested $500,000, Mr. Speaker, to continue the course marine navigation and engineering students at Georgian College. We also helped the college, Mr. Speaker, to transfer some of the equipment from the federal government to this organization. It is the key, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that Georgian College will continue offering this this course, and we will work with our federal counterparts. And as you know, negotiations with the various levels of government takes time, and we are in negotiation with the federal governments. And also, I look forward to talking to municipal leaders in the AMO conference in the future, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Algoma, Manitoulin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning. My question is to the Minister of Finance. Last week, we alerted you to the possible financial crisis many communities could face with the clawback of the Power Dam Special Payment Program. We urge you to work with Wawa, which will lose 47% of their tax base. Last week, you indicated that you were in communication with Wawa to discuss these matters. But the mayor and council have no record of any communication from you on this vital issue.
Whoa.
Zero. Nada. Goose egg. Bupkis. Rien. Poyamu. Nothing. Minister, when can the people of Wawa expect to hear from you?
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite brings forward a matter of great importance to the people of Wawa and to other communities in the north. I very clearly stated that they will be contacted. We will have those deliberations. I've noted that we are going to increase funding to the municipalities. In fact, our budget talks about continuing to support the municipalities, something which, by the way, the member opposite is going to reject by voting away and voting down a budget that's very progressive and talks about the supports for the municipalities. Notwithstanding that, I will continue to work with the City Council. We have made clear that our officials will reach out to the Council and to Wawa and to find ways to support the communities that are going to be affected adversely as a result of the extraordinary effects that this would have on that particular community. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, to the Minister of Finance. Minister, you seem to think that is only the community of Wawa that will suffer greatly with the clawback of this program. Wawa may be the hardest hit, but other communities will be in dire straits and will lose significant amount of money from the Power Dam Compensation Program. And to add insult to injury, these communities haven't received a penny of the monies owed to them from this year's, and their cash is drained. When will your government make good on outstanding payments so these communities can pay their bills?
Yeah, Mr. Speaker, maybe he didn't hear the first response. I did say communities like Wawa and others that would be affected. I did state that there's a consultation process that's going to be underway, that they will reach out to those communities that will be affected to ensure that they're not adversely affected. I also said that OMPF funding has been increased and that supports for the municipalities will continue to ensure that the communities are continuing to have what's necessary. Unlike, Mr. Speaker, what the oppositions have now stated, by opposing this budget, by opposing the progressive nature of what we're putting forward, they are the ones putting them in harm's way. We know that some of the effects that have been proposed in the budget would adversely affect certain communities. We will address them, and we're going through that consultations, and our officials will reach out to them. They know that, and we'll continue to proceed to protect them. But, Mr. Speaker, the members' opposition should stand with this budget to support all communities all across the province of Ontario.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. New question, the member from Ottawa Orleans.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Minister, last August, your predecessor, Minister Jeffrey, announced our government's intention to begin consultation on changing our land use planning and development charges system. Now, almost a year from that announcement, my constituents have numerous questions about what change we may make to the land use planning and appeal system. They found that the current process complicated, difficult to navigate, and even harder to understand. Minister, our government needs to ensure that our planning system works well for municipalities and community groups as well as developers, while remaining responsive to the changing needs of our community. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, can you explain to my constituents what has happened to the feedback that they have given to help change the land use planning system?
Thank you. Minister of Municipal
Affairs. Mr. Speaker, in the 11 seconds I have, I want to begin by thanking the honourable member for her question. Our government believes a strong land use planning system gives municipalities the tools to manage growth so our cities can become communities and our streets can become neighbourhoods. Many, however, find the current system difficult to navigate. So we heard from municipal leaders, planning officials, and the public that the rules can sometimes be too complex and delays and appeals too frustrating. That's why we're taking the input from consultations held in Kitchener, Waterloo, Sault Ste. Marie, Mississauga, Toronto, Thunder Bay, Ottawa, and elsewhere to help our government move forward with a refresh of this important system. We'll continue to listen to everyday Ontarians, municipal politicians, and community groups as we build the stronger, more vibrant communities that we all long for in Ontario.
Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member from Kenora Rainy River has given notice of her dissatisfaction with the answer to her question given by the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs concerning the coroner's inquest into the deaths of 7 First Nations youth. This matter will be debated today at 6 p.m. The member from Algoma, Manitoulin, on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We all have an opportunity to correct the record, and Last week, the Minister of Finance had indicated that we were taking steps with the municipality of Wawa. And his question, in his reply to my question this morning, it certainly wasn't that.
Excuse me, Sam. First of all, that is not a point of order, as the only time you correct a record is your own. This House stands recessed. There are no deferred votes. Another point of order. Not to that. Not to that issue. Sit, please. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.